Good morning and a very warm welcome on this Good Friday morning to St. Paul's Cathedral. Our cathedral stands on the lands of the Kulin nation, and we pay our respects to their elders past, present and emerging, and we welcome any Aboriginal people and Torres Strait Islanders with us this morning. St. Paul's is the home church for Anglicans throughout the province of Victoria, and whether you've come from far or whether this is home for you on a regular basis, we pray that this Good Friday and Eastertide, St. Paul's may be home for you. In our service, there is ample of time for reflection on the great cost of the life given by Jesus so that we all might share in life eternal. There are moments in which we may place signs of our own contrition at the foot of the cross, the flowers that we will be laying in order to remind ourselves of the great joy that will flower from the cross at Eastertide. At the end of our service, we will be sharing in the bread and the wine of the Eucharist, and all baptized Christians are most welcome to share with us in the gift of Christ's presence. Let us pray. Almighty Father, look with mercy on this, your family, for which our Lord Jesus Christ was willing to be betrayed and given up into the hands of sinners and to suffer death upon the cross, who is alive and glorified with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
A reading from the prophecy of Isaiah. Behold, my servant shall prosper. He shall be exalted and lifted up and shall be very high. Just as there were many who were astonished at him, so marred was his appearance beyond human semblance, and his form beyond that of mortals, so he shall startle many nations. Kings shall shut their mouths because of him, for that which had not been told them, they shall see, and that which they had not heard, they shall contemplate. Who has believed what we have heard? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by others, a man of suffering and acquainted with infirmity. And as one from whom others hide their faces, he was despised, and we held him of no account. Surely he has borne our infirmities and carried our diseases. Yet we accounted him stricken, struck down by God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole, and by his bruises we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have all turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. By a perversion of justice he was taken away. Who could have imagined his future? For he was cut off from the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people. They made his grave with the wicked, and his tomb with the rich, although he had done no violence, and there was no deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him with pain. When you make his life an offering for sin, he shall see his offspring. and shall prolong his days. Through him the will of the Lord shall prosper. Out of his anguish he shall see light. He shall find satisfaction through his knowledge. The righteous one, my servant, shall make many righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore I will allot him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out himself to death and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors. Hear the word of the Lord.
Thank you. A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. For the message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since, in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, God decided, through the foolishness of our proclamation, to save those who believe. For Jews demand signs, and Greeks desire wisdom. But we proclaim Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those who are the called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. For God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom, and God's weakness is stronger than human strength. Consider your own call, brothers and sisters. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were powerful. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, things that are not, to reduce to nothing things that are, so that no one might boast in the presence of God. He is the source of your life in Christ Jesus, who became for us wisdom from God, and righteousness and sanctification and redemption, in order that, as it is written, let the one who boasts, boast in the Lord. Hear the word of the Lord.
Thank you. servant had him flogged. And the soldiers wore a crown of thorns and put it on his head, and they dressed him in a purple robe. They kept coming up to him, saying,
Thank you.
handed him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and carrying a cross by himself, he went out to what is called the place of the skull, which in Hebrew is called Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, with Jesus between them. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross. It read, Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews. Many of the Jews read this inscription because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city. And it was written in Hebrew, in Latin, and in Greek. Then the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate,
Christ was the King of the Jews, but that he said, I am the King of the Jews.
Pilate answered, what I have written, I have written. When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four parts, one for each soldier. They also took his tunic. Now the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top. So they said to one another, since it was the day of preparation, the Jews did did not want the bodies left on the cross during the Sabbath, especially because that Sabbath was a day of great solemnity. So they asked Pilate to have the legs of the crucified men broken and the bodies removed. Then the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once blood and water came out. He who saw this has testified, so that you also may believe. His testimony is true, and he knows that he tells the truth. These things occurred so that the scripture might be fulfilled. None of his bones shall be broken. And again, another passage of scripture says, they will look on the one whom they have.
In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. As we entered the cathedral this morning, it was in silence. As we leave, it will be in silence. Sometimes it is not just through words, but also through their absence that we apprehend those things that are deepest and most meaningful. I expect that there was silence for any who stood and watched the death of Jesus and those crucified with him. The Sabbath that approached was, we're told, a great day of great solemnity. But apart from that, any who gave this gruesome spectacle of crucifixion any attention would have been watching and listening. Were the crucified men still alive? Were any words forming on their dying lips? Could a blessing or even a cursing be discerned that would truly disclose their guilt or innocence? The Synoptic Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, record that the world was covered in darkness in Jesus' final hours on the cross. Not just a lack of noise, but a lack of light, perhaps suggesting that the primordial chaos was close to engulfing the created order once again. After all, it had been the fiat lux, or let there be light, command from God that commenced the ordering of all that would unfold over the 6 days of creation. Its withdrawal, now emphasizing the enormity of what took place in humanity's rejection of the Son of God as he hung on the cross at Calvary. Silence also draws us into the sharper reality of our own mortality. As we were born from darkness and silence, so we will go into that state at our death. During the span of our life, we have choice, the opportunity to decide, to go deeper into life's purpose or not. The same choices that we know are differently exercised by people who figure in the gospel narrative today. Whether it was Pilate or Peter, Judas or Mary, the mother of Jesus, Mary Magdalene or the beloved disciple, choices were on display for all to see that disclosed how they truly responded to God in the person of Jesus, his son. It's the same for us today as we sit and ponder, or come to venerate the cross or receive the Holy Communion. The silence searches out our hearts for the answer to the question Jesus put to Simon Peter, "Who do you say that I am?" Peter's answer to that question, according to Matthew's Gospel, is the emphatic, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." The clarity of this recognition out of the variety of possibilities that have been canvassed amongst the group of Jesus' disciples stands throughout the ages as the exemplar of the Christian's confession of personal belief. Like Peter, we are faced with that same choice. And some amongst us today can undoubtedly recall reaching this place of certainty about who Jesus is and what that means for them in their life. Perhaps there are others amongst us for whom that remains an open question. Probably for most of us, we understand the pathos of Peter's denial of Jesus as he attempts to be anonymous around a fire on a cold night as he is recognized as Jesus' disciple. Are there any amongst us who could not be more courageous in proclaiming Christ as Messiah and Lord in the ordinary round of our own daily life? From the most ancient times of the Christian Church, the words from the prophet Micah have seemed fitting to encapsulate God's response to the rejection of Jesus and his death on the cross. The Good Friday liturgy echoes God's challenge to Israel to recall the divine faithfulness shown within their own history. And Micah 6:3 continues, "O my people, what have I done to you? In what have I wearied you? Answer me. For I brought you up from the land of Egypt and redeemed you from the house of slavery, and I sent before you Moses, Aaron, and Miriam." The ministry of Jesus, likewise, was well known for healing, release, and wholeness amongst the captives and the broken people of his own day. He lived an uncommonly good life, even seeking God's forgiveness for those who put him to death. No wonder the work of God within human history was at the forefront of the early church's remembrance, and as we commemorate today. The Brazilian artist Guido Rocha sculpted a hyper-realistic depiction of the crucifixion that was informed by his own experiences of torture. This work was on display at the 1975 World Council of Churches Assembly in Nairobi. In Rocha's work, an almost skeletal Jesus screams in agony from the cross. Underneath his sculpture of what he called the tortured Christ, he inscribed these words: "The characteristic of Christ is that his life was totally coherent, so coherent that the world would not stand him." For people of every age, the crucifixion has opened up a window on their own personal or societal experience. The truth is that whether it is Rocha's sculpture or the suffering of many in the world today, we would rather look away and prefer to cloak ourselves in the anonymity that Simon Peter sought as he stood near the warming fire. The coherence and goodness of Jesus' life and his proclamation of the now and coming kingdom of God always stands in stark contrast to the means of his death. The cross, in that way, is rich in meaning, since it is not just evocative of the way he died, but the way he lived and what he lived to proclaim. Good Friday and our liturgical observance of the events of Jesus' passion and death hold before us the choice of embracing God's purposes revealed in Jesus or choosing whatever warming fire that seems fit. St. Paul, in his letter to the Romans, sums up the resolution of this choice as he exhorts fellow Christian believers to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds, so that you may discern what is the will of God. In other words, our Christian faith is to be lived as an embodied faith in our daily life. Through our faith, Christ's mission is continued as a transforming reality for us and for all whom we encounter. A little later today, after this service has concluded, all are welcome to join the ecumenical walk of prayer and reflection at the stations of the cross throughout the city. Usually the timing works out that I'm able to meet up with the pilgrimage after it's commenced, and generally at St. Patrick's Cathedral or the Lutheran Church in MacArthur Street, opposite the parliamentary precinct. I mention this because a pilgrimage like this highlights the reality of our own journey of discipleship, of affirmation that Jesus is Messiah and Lord, or facing that choice of preferring our own particular warming fire, of looking into the face of Jesus in agony, on the cross, or looking away. And as I walk down through the heart of Melbourne and stop with other pilgrims to pray and recall Jesus' journey to the cross, I'm struck by the contrast between what we're doing and the commonplace activity that otherwise occupies a place like Collins Street throughout all the other days and weeks of the year. The stations of the cross throughout the city are large and on prominent display to the public. But I suspect that for the countless thousands who walk past them each day, they may well just seem some more religious art. And two are on our own cathedral precinct on Swanson Street and on Flinders Street. And what is remarkable about the Good Friday pilgrimage is that it is the one public occasion when the whole story that those stations of the cross evoke is actually told sequentially. The trams are stopped, the traffic diverted, and the pilgrims fill the streets to proclaim the sacred Christian story. What I like is the emphasis that this pilgrimage makes about Christianity being a faith to be lived out in public, not just to be held in private. This was the difficult and challenging choice that Simon Peter was confronted with as he stood around the warming fire and denied that he was one of Jesus' disciples. Paul Gerhardt wrote the hymn, "O Sacred Head Now Wounded," in the midst of his experience of the 30 Years' War in Germany during the 17th century. That was a hymn we sang just before the proclamation of the Passion Gospel. And Gerhard had grown up in difficult circumstances after the death of his father while he was still a young boy. Despite the austerity of his personal circumstances and the suffering generally he experienced on account of the constant warfare of his age, he completed his theological studies and became a Lutheran pastor. You might think that was a happy end for him, but this was not to be the change of fortunes, as you might think, since he was soon in conflict with Friedrich Wilhelm the Great of Brandenburg, who sought to suppress Lutheranism in favor of his own Calvinist faith. Dispossessed from his appointment, and weighed down with grief through the death of several of his children and his wife during this period, Gerhard knew the depth of personal suffering. This hymn, a portion of which we just sang, was based on poems written many centuries before him by Bernard of Clairvaux. And the opening words of John chapter 19 that's been dramatically sung in our Passion leap out from that hymn. And I mention this because Gerhard's hymn holds together the reality of the choice that we all must confront. What language shall I borrow to thank thee, dearest friend, for this thy dying sorrow, thy pity without end? And then, tellingly, he faces the question of personal choice that I've been speaking about this morning. O make me thine forever, and should I fainting be, Lord, let me never, never outlive my love to thee. Lord, let me never, never outlive my love to thee. What a powerful prayer for us to make our own. In the living of our faith, there'll be many warming fires that beckon and even encourage us to forget Jesus and who we are with him. The great truth of Good Friday is that no matter what we are and how we decide, we are not forgotten by Jesus. We may be even undeserving or complicit through our denials, but no matter what, his love reaches out to us.
behold the wood of the cross on which was hung the Saviour of the world.
Come, let us worship him. God sent his Son into the world not to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. Therefore, let us pray for people everywhere, according to their needs.
In peace, let us pray for the Holy Church of God throughout the world, that God, the Almighty Father, will guide and gather it together in peace and tranquility. God of compassion, you have shown your glory to all nations in Christ your Son. Guide the work of your church, help it to preserve in faith, to proclaim your name, and to bring your salvation to all people. Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons, especially for Philip, our primate and archbishop, and Andreas, our dean. For all men and women who have a special ministry in the church, for those preparing for baptism and confirmation, and for all God's people. God of compassion, by your Holy Spirit, you teach your church and make us holy. Help each of us to do your work more faithfully.
Amen.
Let us pray for all who share our faith in Christ, that God may gather and keep together in one community all those who sincerely seek the truth. God of compassion, by our baptism you have made us one with Christ in the life of his church. Make us one with each other in faith and love and service. Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray for all who seek after Christ, that the light of the Holy Spirit may show them the way to salvation. God of compassion, whose Son was lifted up from the earth to draw all people to himself, may all who long to find you and in you find their peace come to acknowledge you as the Maker and Redeemer of us all.
Amen.
Let us pray for all who serve in public office, that God may guide their minds and hearts so that all may live in peace and freedom. God of compassion, you know the longings of our hearts and you desire justice for all. Guide those in authority that people everywhere may enjoy and rightly use freedom, security, and peace.
Amen.
Let us pray that the God from whom all tenderness and healing flows may heal the sick, comfort the dying, give safety to travellers, free those unjustly deprived of liberty, and rid the world of falsehood, hunger, and disease. God of compassion, you give strength to the weary and new courage to those who have lost heart. Have mercy on all who are in trouble, that they may know the joy of receiving your help in their hour of need.
Amen. Amen. Let us commit ourselves to God and pray for the grace of a holy life, that with all who have departed this world and have died in the peace of Christ, and those whose faith is known to God alone, we may be counted worthy to enter into the fullness of the joy of our Lord and receive the crown of life in the day of resurrection. We make these prayers through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
40 years I led you through the desert and fed you with manna and brought you into an exceedingly good land.
Yet you prepare a cross for your Savior. Holy God.
We adore you, O Christ, and we bless you, for by your cross you have redeemed the world. Amen. Please stand to sing. Jesus taught us to call God our Father, and by his death on the cross made us children of God by adoption. And so each in our own language or the version we know best, we pray the prayer that he has given his church. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. The gifts of God for the people of God. Come, let us take this holy sacrament of the body and blood of Christ in remembrance that he died for us and feed on him in our hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Eternal life. The blood of Christ keep you in eternal life. Most merciful God, who by the death and resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, delivered and saved the world, grant that by faith in him who suffered on the cross, we may triumph in the power of his victory. Through Jesus Christ, your Son alone, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen.